everyone. Welcome to In Depth. I'm your host, Aditi Nagpal Girotra. Plastic is today seen as one of the biggest pollutants on Earth. It is literally everywhere, present in homes, vehicles, garbage heaps, oceans and rivers, even in the stomachs of unsuspecting birds, animals and humans, slowly choking their lives. Not so far back in the past, plastic was considered one of the most useful substances that mankind had produced. It was cheap and used to make almost everything, from clothes to furniture, toys to packaging material. From the 1950s up to 2018, 6.3 billion tons of plastic has been produced worldwide. Only 9% of this has been recycled and 12% has been incinerated, which is why it is only in recent years that people have really begun to protest against the overuse of plastic. The worldwide campaign against plastic cuts across countries. Efforts are being made to reduce plastic pollution by reducing its consumption, cleaning up litter, and promoting plastic recycling. Today in depth, we look at the size of the plastic economy and why it has become such a huge environmental challenge, the worldwide efforts to limit the damage caused by plastic, and what does the future hold for use of plastic. In the late 19th century, a revolutionary material was created that changed the way people lived. Soon, plastic began to be known as a wonder material that was affordable, lightweight, and durable, and could reduce the use of natural material like wood, bones, leather, ivory, etc. But what exactly is plastic and what makes it versatile? And at the same time, one of the biggest environmental challenges facing the planet. Here's a report.
It's the age of plastic. A sea of products made from this versatile polymer that is now posing one of the greatest climatic challenges facing the Earth. Currently, 12.7 million tons of plastic is washing up in our oceans each year, choking our aquatic life and environment. Coming from the Greek word plastikos, the word plastic means moldable. Plastic comprises many synthetic or man-made polymers that are malleable and can be molded into solid objects. Polymers are very large molecules consisting of smaller molecules called monomers that are similar to each other and joined together in a straight chain. In the 19th century, scientists did not fully understand or identify polymers. Till 1861, British chemist Thomas Graham observed that when he dissolved organic compounds in solutions, they would not pass through even the finest filter paper without leaving sticky residue. This experiment led to the invention of plastic in the coming years. Plastics are typically organic polymers of high molecular mass and often contain other substances. Most of these polymers are formed from chains of carbon atoms, either pure or with the addition of oxygen, nitrogen, or sulfur. Plastics are usually synthetic and are commonly derived from petrochemicals. An array of variants are made from renewable materials like polylactic acid from corn or cellulosics from cotton linters. Plasticity is the general property of all materials which can deform irreversibly without breaking. Moldable polymers or plastic derive their name from this specific ability.
Plastic basically is a crude oil product. It's manufactured from crude oil. After refining of crude oil, plastics are made. It's a product of crude oil. That is what it is. I mean, if you refine, you get petrol, diesel, etc. In the same way, after refining of crude oil, you get naphtha sometimes, and you get it's a product of crude oil. Plastics are of multiple types. I mean, so many types now, every year a new type of plastic is invented. Basically, it is polymers, which has low density polyethylene, high density polyethylene, polypropylene, ethyl vinyl acetate, PVC, etc. These are all the polymers which are used maximum number for different varieties, for different types of uses.
Soon after its development in the late 19th century, plastic became known as the wonder material due to its low cost, ease of manufacture, versatility and imperviousness to water. It was used in a variety of products of different scale, from paper clips to spacecraft. It was also used in the medical field, including medical equipment and polymer implants.
It became popular for many reasons. Number one, it was light. It was inexpensive. It has substituted so many things because of the ease of usability. Plastics can be used in so many ways. It has substituted now even metal, paper, cloth. It has substituted paper, it has substituted cloth, it has substituted metal. In fact, many parts of all auto parts are made of plastic.
There was a time when plastic was looked at as a savior of nature for reducing the use of wood, stone, metal, bone, leather, etc. However, in the past few decades, plastics have saturated our world, especially with the advent of single-use plastics. In developed economies, about a third of plastic is used in packaging. In India, 42% of plastic consumption is for packaging. With an alarming rate in its usage, the material that was once termed as revolutionary is now choking the world. And now needs another revolution to free the planet of this menace. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The need for a new material rose purely for selfish and very personal reasons when an American billionaire obsessed with the game of billiards announced a prize for the invention of a material that could replace ivory. And so was born celluloid, a part natural, part synthetic polymer that was quite malleable. Then in the early 20th century, a completely synthetic material was invented, bakelite, which was even more moldable, and went on to become a staple in millions of homes in the form of cutlery, furniture and accessories. Let's take a look at the growth of plastic.
John Wesley Hyatt created the world's first polymer in 1869. He was inspired by a New York firm's offer of $10,000 for anyone who could provide a substitute for ivory. That was because the growing popularity of billiards had put a strain on the supply of natural ivory, which is obtained through the slaughter of wild elephants. So John Hyatt and his brother Isaiah set about the task of inventing a new substance. They treated cellulose, which is derived from cotton fiber, with camphor. The resulting material, plastic, could be crafted into a variety of shapes and made to imitate natural substances like tortoise shell, horn, linen and ivory. For the first time in human history, manufacturing was not constrained by the limits of nature. Nature could only supply so much wood, metal, stone, bone, tusk and horn, but this was a new material, not dependent on nature. The discovery was nothing less than revolutionary. Celluloid was advertised as the savior of elephants and tortoise. It was said to be able to protect the natural world from the destructive forces of human need. In 1907, Leo Baekeland invented Bakelite, the first fully synthetic plastic without any molecules found in nature. Baekeland's discovery was the result of the search of a synthetic substitute for shellac, a natural electrical insulator, to meet the growing needs of a rapidly electrifying America. Bakelite was a good insulator, was durable, heat-resistant, and unlike celluloid, ideally suited for mechanical mass production. It was marketed as the material of 1,000 uses. Bakelite could be shaped or molded into almost anything, which provided endless possibilities. From household items to radios could be made from Bakelite. These early successes led to major research into the development of new polymers. This was when the boom that plastic was considered to be started to turn into humankind's bane. Research programs sought new plastics not for specific usage, but for their own sake. Their uses could be found later. Plastic came of age during World War II, when countries saw industrial might to be as important to victory as military success. There was an increased need to preserve the already scarce natural resources, and plastics emerged as the go-to material. Nylon was invented in 1935. Then came plexiglass as an alternative to glass for aircraft windows. During World War II, plastic production in the United States of America increased by 300%. The post-war era saw a surge in plastic production. Much of what Americans bought then was made of plastic. Plastic replaced steel in cars, paper and glass in packaging, and wood in furniture. By the year 1965, plastic had penetrated each and every aspect of human life. This was also the 13th consecutive year that plastics registered record growth. The throwaway containers or single-use plastic boxes were increasingly replacing reusable ones. From a 96% return rate of reusable containers in 1950, the rate of return fell to below 5% by 1970. By the 1970s, plastic was replacing glass, cotton, and cardboard. All major soft drinks companies were giving up their glass bottles and moving towards plastic. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
With this, we'll halt in for a short break on In Depth, but we'll be back soon. Stay tuned with us. In 1950s, the world's population of 2.5 billion produced 1.5 million tons of plastic. In 2016, a global population of more than 7 billion people produced over 320 million tons of plastic. What is alarming is that most of the plastic we consume in our daily lives is not capable of being decomposed by bacteria or other living organisms. It can hang around in the environment for hundreds of years, leading to pollution and causing environmental damage.
Each year, 400 million tons of plastic is produced, and 40% of that is single use, meaning plastic that will be used only once before it is dumped. The disposable plastic products we use every day are anything but disposable in environmental terms and can take over 400 years to biodegrade. Some examples of single-use plastic are carrier bags, drinks bottles, and chips packets. The booming production of plastics in recent years, which is partly fueled by demand for single-use items, means the world has manufactured more plastic in the last decade than in the whole of the previous century. Experts and scientists are increasingly urging the public to reduce daily garbage production to save the planet from a destructive fate.
It has been used irresponsibly now that the problem has arisen. Even then, it is on the rise. It is on the consumer's part, on the part of society, to use it more responsibly.
To do this, it is crucial to know how long it takes for our garbage to decompose. The plastic bags that we use daily take from 10 years to 1,000 years to decompose, while plastic bottles can take 450 years or more. A battery will decompose in 100 years, exposing the heavy metals inside, which will never decompose and are toxic for the environment. Cigarette butts can take 1 to 4 years to decompose. The styrofoam cups we regularly use to drink our beverages and throw in the bin after each use take over 50 years to decompose. Diapers and sanitary napkins can also take over 400 years to decompose. Another issue is that not all plastic can be recycled. In fact, many scientists believe that certain plastics never truly decompose. Since they can't be broken down by microorganisms, they gradually turn into smaller and smaller pieces of plastic, which seep down into the soil and release chemicals that eventually reach the water supply. Although plastic recycling did begin to spread around the world in the 1970s, it did not gain much momentum as it is a costlier endeavor than the actual production of the product. In fact, it is estimated that only 9% of the plastic produced gets recycled. More than 8 million tons of plastic enters the world's oceans each year, most of it from land. It is estimated that 60-70% of the plastic sinks to the bottom of the ocean, where it gets brittle and breaks into tiny pieces and mixes into the plankton, which is at the heart of the marine food chain. 1 lakh marine mammals and turtles and 1 million seabirds are killed by marine plastic pollution annually. Recent studies have revealed marine plastic pollution in 100% of marine turtles, 59% of whales, 36% of seals and 40% of seabird species examined. Experts believe that by 2050, the amount of plastic in the ocean will weigh more than the amount of fish in it.
Where oceans, thousands, lakhs of tons of plastic are swirling around in oceans, which are harming the sea life, you know.
A latest study looks at the health impacts of every stage in the life cycle of plastics. The extraction of the oil and gas needed to make plastic releases toxic chemicals into the air and water, which can cause cancer and damage the nervous system. Some plastics we know are toxic. It contains phthalates and heavy metals and creates dioxins when it burns. Other plastics contain bisphenol A or BPA, which has been identified as a chemical that disrupts hormones. Plastics can contain thousands of possible additives, and manufacturers are not required to disclose their recipes. This makes it more difficult to fight the menace. Any plastic can leach depending on the conditions and what additives it includes. Experts recommend avoiding plastics when possible, particularly in toys and products that come in contact with food or drink. So how can we remove plastic from our lives? Simply by introducing small changes to reduce our plastic footprint. The first step involves avoiding buying items such as plastic bottles of water and carrying a permanent or reusable bottle of water instead. Carrying reusable cutlery like a cup, plate, tissues and straws can help cut down single use of plastic. Always carry a reusable bag for your groceries. Buying local and loose fruits and vegetables instead of food which is imported and comes wrapped in plastic sheets. Consumers can cut down on waste by opting for bars of soap over the liquid form and naked toiletries such as shampoo bars. To minimize the waste produced every year, zero waste movement is also picking up pace. Zero waste essentially means reduction of weight by recycling products you already have. From the 1950s to the 1970s, only a small amount of plastic was produced, so plastic waste was relatively manageable. By the 1990s, however, plastic waste generation had more than tripled in 2 decades, following a similar rise in plastic production. In the early 2000s, our output of plastic waste rose more in a single decade than it had in the previous 40 years. Today, we produce about 400 million tons of plastic waste every year, which is nearly equivalent to the weight of the entire human population. Our planet is drowning in an ocean of plastic, and the time to save it is now. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
It's only in recent years that the world has woken up to the potential threat posed by plastics to the environment and human health. This is also why scientists are attempting to make plastics safer and more sustainable.
Years of innovation has gone into the mass production of plastic. Its growth has been the result of a successful consumerism of the post-World War II generation. Although plastic production generates cheap goods, 90% of goods produced by the plastic economy are used just once and discarded, which creates a Himalayan crisis of waste disposal. We have known for a while that bulk plastics are polluting the oceans. Converging sea currents are accumulating plastic waste in a floating island known as the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, which now covers an area larger than Greenland. The bigger bits of plastic are life-threatening to marine life and seabirds. They are strangling marine mammals or birds and building up in their stomachs and guts. Microplastics are polluting the food chain. By 2050, it is expected there will be as much plastic in the sea as there is fish. There is a growing need to design new materials that can replace plastic. The new materials need to have all the positive aspects of plastic, which is durable, lightweight, cheap, and replace all the negative ones, which includes made from fossil fuels, non-recyclable and non-biodegradable.
The best thing about plastic is can be recycled many times over. Now, where is the bottleneck in the whole chain? The bottleneck is collection. It has to be collected, segregated. There are many methods of recycling. One of the recent methods is pyrolysis. I mean, they collect plastic. Plastic is a product from oil. And they take the oil back as a light diesel oil. There are now technologies, very viable, economic, and wonderful technologies.
Bio-derived plastics are good replacements for plastic. These include starch-based plastics like polyactide, produced from cornstarch, cassava roots or sugarcane, and processed in the same way as petroleum-based plastics. Such plastics are used to make drink bottles. Companies are also coming up with eco-friendly, biodegradable and even edible packaging solutions. Indonesian company produces seaweed-based plastic that dissolves in warm water. It is 100% biodegradable and is not only safe to eat, but also contains good fibers, vitamins and minerals naturally found in seaweed. Another innovation, Nuaton, is a new sustainable material made out of 100% raw renewable resources, polymerized from cornstarch and metabolized by microorganisms. It supposedly has a lifespan of up to 15 years and can withstand temperatures of up to 110 degrees Celsius. Some innovators are searching for ways to make recycling more efficient and even hope to perfect a process that converts plastic back into the fossil fuel from which they were derived. Plastics will still be an important part of our future, but reducing its consumption will have a significant impact on the environment. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And that's it from us today in In-Depth. We'll be back same time on Monday with a focus on some other subject. In case you missed the television broadcast, you can also watch our program online on YouTube, the link for which is given below. Suggestions and feedback about the program are also welcome. Thank you for your time.